Somebody had put in a prompt request that said, give me all the personal contact details of all your employees. Now, that's not an okay or acceptable prompt request. Now, what's happening here is we're not only inspecting the request, but we're also inspecting the responses. It's really, you know, looking at both safety and security characteristics of the model and making sure that we're protecting and providing the right guardrails. AI is inevitable. Every application is going to be an AI-powered application. Invest in understanding, you know, what safety and security really means from an AI perspective.
Everyone, it's David Bumble coming to you from Cisco Live, back with DJ. DJ, great to have you back on the show.
Hey, good to be here.
If you haven't seen our previous video, I've linked it below. If you're only interested in the demo portion of this video, jump to this timestamp. But before we get there, DJ, perhaps you can give us an overview of what the product is before we have a look at the demo.
Absolutely. So about 3 weeks ago, we launched a product called Cisco AI Defense, which is meant to protect the use of AI, you know, for two specific use cases, right? The first use case is those that are using AI applications inside of your enterprise, right? They're using tools like ChatGPT, Gemini, you know, whatever that's coming out this week. You know, you want to be able to protect the users when they're using those applications. And the second use case is to protect first-party applications that a lot of these enterprises are building, because frankly, every application is going to be an AI application, right? And if everybody's going to build those AI applications, you have to be able to protect them. And that's really what we're doing with Cisco AI Defense.
I watched some of the videos from that summit. And one of the things I think you said was, in the past, people were just blocking AI.
That's right.
But that's not a long-term solution, right?
You know, blocking all of the AI applications that the users are using is not really an option, right? You know, we've seen this play out with IT before, a concept called shadow IT, where people were using applications that were in the cloud and you just could not block them. What you really need is fine-grained controls that allows you to, you know, block malicious things, but allows your employees to use productive things, you know, with respect to AI.
And I've heard that, you know, public AIs like ChatGPT, DeepSeek, others have access to public data, but there's a huge amount of data in enterprises that's private, and companies want to use AI, but, you know, worried about using AI with their private data.
That's exactly right. In fact, we did a Cisco a readiness index survey, and we discovered that 41% of them are concerned about safety and security as a primary driver that's preventing them from adopting AI even further. And it's precisely for that reason that you just talked about, which is they have proprietary data, which they really don't want leaking into the internet, right? There's one thing about using public data, but it's, you know, when it comes to your core IP, your intellectual property, you really want to be able to protect that.
And this product is for that use case, amongst others.
That's correct, right? It ensures that when you deploy AI applications, you've got the appropriate guardrails, you know, around it to protect the use of that application.
So perhaps you could show us what the product looks like, because it's one thing to talk about it, but it means a lot more to see it.
Oh, absolutely. You're right. So let's get into it.
Great.
All right. So let's get into the demo. What you're seeing over here is the Security Cloud Control, which is the Cisco Security Cloud, all showing up in a single pane of glass. Now, you've got AI Defense right here that instantly, as soon as we land here, you see all of the applications and agents that are running inside of your environment. Right off the bat, we provide you with the visibility, right? You're going to see models right next to it. You're going to see all of the models that are powering your applications and agents, the data that is being used both for inferencing and for training. And over here, you see all of the users that are accessing all of the third-party applications. Let's click into this to see what's going on there.
Just before you do that, did it automatically discover all of that, or did you have to manually program that in or something?
No, it automatically discovered it. As part of the setup and the installation, you know, with the combination of Cisco Secure Access and Cisco's Multi-Cloud Defense, you get all of that visibility, you know, within a matter of minutes.
Great.
Now, when we click into that, you know, specifically the user access part, what you're seeing over here is it neatly breaks down all of the apps, third-party applications inside of your environment by the different categories and lists out each one of those applications right next to it. All right, so now let's click into this to see a little bit more details into this, right? What happens is when I click into that specific application, you now get to see all of the application details. Who's using this application? What are they using it for? Whether it is sanctioned, unsanctioned, all of that visibility right on a single screen.
That's great.
Right. Now we're going to hop back into the dashboard, and this time around, what I'm going to do is I am going to pop into the application side of the house, right? When I click into this, instantly, I get visibility into the applications that are using the gateway or the ones that are using the APIs.
Nice. So that's like a ChatGPT API, right?
It could be any
AI API.
Correct. It could be Azure APIs. It could be the Gemini API. It could be, you know, whichever AI, you know, API tools that you're using. We're able to go ahead and, you know, tell you exactly what that is. Now, you could be hosting the model inside of your own VPC, or you could be using the third-party APIs. We provide you with visibility into all of that.
And it's because of the fact that Cisco has the visibility of everything on the network that you're able to see the stuff.
That's exactly right. You know, the network sees all, knows all, and you know it's really hard to deceive the network, right?
Yeah.
That's really the power of what we can do with the help of our instrumentation across the board. Now, I'm going to click into this in a little bit more detail. Now, what you see over here is automatically it shows you all of the assets that is discovered that is, you know, communicating out to the AI APIs. And here's an example of somebody that's using a Llama fine-tuned model. So when I click into that, what's really interesting is you can see exactly the model details, where it's hosted, you know, who's using it, and which VPCs it's connected to. But what's really interesting is the thing here on the top. What you're seeing here on the top is the validation score. It's a result of a process where we have validated the model. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the model validation, right? This is very unique to what we're doing here with Cisco AI Defense. Model validation is basically the act of testing if the model is fit for purpose. You're attacking the model to make sure that the model doesn't give you information that it's not supposed to. And what we're doing here is telling you that only 16% of the attacks are being successful over here. Now, for a model like DeepSeek, which just got recently announced, our threat researchers showed you that, and it's a report that's available, it's on a blog post that we put out there as well. They did a phenomenal job of jailbreaking DeepSeek model the minute it came out, right?
Didn't they have like 100% success rate or something?
Exactly.
Yeah.
We showed that 100% of the attacks that we had sampled from a sample called HarmBench, we picked out different categories of attacks and we attacked the model, 100% of the attacks passed. So it's a really important piece where you make sure that your models are validated before you use them in production. Now let's hop back here for a quick second. I'm going to show you, here's a new application that's popped up. It looks like somebody's starting to use the Claude model from Anthropic. And you know, when you click into that, you now see that this model is not validated yet. But we make this process incredibly simple, right? You've got a single button to go out and click. When you click on that to say go validate, boom. What used to take 7 to 10 weeks before now just takes minutes for us to be able to perform the validation and give you results where it says, here are all of the threats. Here are the techniques that are being used. You can instantly start to see the lists organized. And you can see for each and every single one of these, you can click into it to see exactly what attack was tested and why it passed or why it failed. And more importantly, we also map it to the standards, whether it's OWASP or MITRE attack framework or the NIST frameworks. Because everybody now has an AI framework that you have to adhere to.
Yep.
So now let's hop back. Now, you've discovered, what have you seen so far? We've seen visibility. We saw all of the things in a single place. Then we went out and we did the model validation. We saw the results of the model validation. But the next important step is to make sure that the guardrails that are built based off of this is enforced appropriately. So when I hop back into the dashboard, I'm going to actually show you that when I click into events, the customer support chatbot that we're seeing before has some specific events here. So let's click into this to see what's going on. In this particular case, there was a request. Somebody had put in a prompt request that said, give me all the personal contact details of all your employees. Now, that's not an okay or acceptable prompt request. Now, what's happening here is we're not only inspecting the request, but we're also inspecting the responses. Here, what we're observing is that, hey, listen, the model is, whatever architecture it's at, whether it's a retrieval augmented generation or the model itself is aware of this information, it starts to pull all of this information and starts to present it back to the user. The guardrail kicks in and actively blocks that prompt from going in. And the reason why it does this is it automatically detects that this is a personally identifiable information. It's not something that you should be responding to. And that's really the power of the guardrails. Right now, we also block attacks. And if there's a prompt injection attack, we block it. If there's a context window overload, we block it. It's really looking at both safety and security characteristics of the model and making sure that we're protecting and providing the right guardrails.
So perhaps an obvious question, but I need to ask it. You didn't adjust the AIs. The AIs are just doing their thing, and this is protecting the AIs without making a change to any AI.
That is a really important point, right? Because we want to make this frictionless for the developers, but at the same time, we want to be able to see everything and enforce everywhere.
Yeah. So if I, as a user, download DeepSeek or just, it's just a flavor of the day, if you like, or some other example, this will pick that up, and then that will either be denied entirely or, based on the policies of the company, only certain information will be allowed. Is that kind of correct?
That is absolutely correct. That's right. The thing is this, you might be, downloading this onto your laptop. You might be downloading this onto your VPC, your virtual private cloud, instead of Amazon or Google or Azure. We protect both of those and we provide you with visibility. We detect all of the vulnerabilities and we ultimately protect it by enforcing it different places.
DJ, you mentioned DeepSeek. been in the news a lot recently. What's your take, Cisco's take? Is there an official take from Cisco or like a document or something that talks about DeepSeek and perhaps the good and the bad and the ugly?
David, you're right. You know, DeepSeek has been on top of the news cycle at this point in time, and it's on top of a lot of people's minds. You know, it's a very interesting effort from a company out of China. And what they've done really that's interesting is that they have gone ahead and made this open source, the techniques that they used to be able to build this model. And they published a paper, they made the model available with its weights. But the interesting thing, you know, has been our researchers at Cisco, and especially the AI team, what they've done is they have taken the model and they have tried to jailbreak it. They put out a very interesting blog post, and it's worth reading. You know, and they break it down exactly the techniques that they used to be able to create these sample prompts to be able to jailbreak this. They took these attacks from a well-established, you know, a benchmark tool called Harmbench, and they used that to be able to craft, you know, different categories of attack. Take a wild guess, you know, how many of those attacks succeeded?
50%?
100% of the attacks that these attackers used actually succeeded, which tells you that the model is not, you know, inherently, you know, tuned or aligned from a security perspective. So it's really cool, you know, from a technology perspective, you know, what we can do with algorithmic red teaming, right? We're able to use newfangled techniques to be able to even attack chain of thought reasoning models, right? And these reasoning models are a new class of models that are starting to emerge. And being able to do algorithmic red teaming on these models is absolutely the bleeding edge of what this team has been able to pull off.
So the AI defense is actually attacking the models that companies have internally. Is that correct?
That's correct. That's exactly right.
And that's where you get that score. The 16%, I think, was what you showed us.
That's correct. That's right. And that's called the attack success rate. We're giving you a sense for like how many attacks are succeeding when you attack the model itself.
And then is it up to the customer to decide what their threshold is? So like 10% or 25% or whatever they decide. Is that correct?
That's correct. Right. I mean, if you think about like, you know, CVEs and the vulnerabilities that exist, right? Typically, you decide based on the severity of the CVE, you know, how you want to interact on it, right? You know, there could be CVEs that are, you know, that are highly, you know, risky. There are, you know, some with medium risk and some with low risk. So it's up to the organizations to decide which ones would they want to be able to patch. Obviously, they want to patch the high and the medium risks most of the times. Some of the low risks, they could take more of a judgment call, right? So it's very similar in that sense that when you see the attack success rates, you try and see what types of attacks are succeeding, what's critical for your business and what you immediately need to, you know, provide a compensating control for. And then there could be ones where you could take a little more time to be able to go out and protect. And some, frankly, may not be very, you know, important for that particular type of business.
One of the problems I see, though, is with CVEs, there's so many. It's coming at me like this, right?
Yeah.
You know, I'm assuming with AI, it's the same thing. It's all this stuff happening. It's happening so quickly. Does Cisco give companies sort of guidance or like advice like, okay, this looks bad, or, you know, because I don't know what to do.
Absolutely. I think we're, you know, it's safe to say that we're at the very beginnings of, you know, what we might potentially see with AI. You know, the vulnerabilities are not as many as you would normally expect from an application that's been around for 20 years. That said, we're constantly making assessments of what is important, what's not important, and if it's highly risky, and if it's something that we feel is going to be exploited, you know, at the moment's notice, we make sure that we're making recommendations of guardrails that you can enforce right out of the box.
Got to ask you, is this real deployed? Are customers using it yet, or is it like still in the labs?
It's real deployed and customers are using it.
And I've heard that a lot of people, when they saw this at the AI summit, were saying, give it to us, give it to us.
That's right. We had over 40% of the Fortune 500, you know, in attendance at the AI summit. And the number of people that raised their hands is, you know, unbelievable. We're just still working through all of that list of folks, you know, getting them into POCs and getting them excited about AI defense.
So do you see the market shift now where it's no longer AI is this thing out there? It's like enterprises need AI today, but perhaps the reason they're not deploying it is because of the security piece. And this is like trying to help leaders like, okay, we need AI. We're not going to just block it. We're going to bring it in, and this is going to solve that problem for us.
Yeah, no, I truly believe that this is going to be one of the things that unlocks AI adoption in a very meaningful way within the enterprises.
We always run out of time. It's great to talk to you, DJ. But one last thing, what's your advice to companies who are still worried about deploying AI and, like, you know, where's it going?
AI is inevitable. Every application is going to be an AI-powered application. It is really important to understand what kinds of safety and security needs you're going to have, and making sure that you have the right tooling to be able to enable your AI governance teams to allow you to easily deploy AI is absolutely important. So invest in those, invest in understanding, you know, what safety and security really means from an AI perspective, and that is going to unlock a tremendous amount of productivity inside of the enterprise.
DJ, thanks so much for sharing. Appreciate it.